Nikita and Shobhana Agarwal, who are the founder and promoter of this platform, Large Scale Statistics. And I have been following the activities of this particular organization. They have been very religiously and diligently conducting several such classes and the other courses. This is indeed a very noble work for spreading the legal knowledge, disseminating the legal knowledge not only amongst the legal professionals, students, but also those who are stakeholders. The topic is very, very broad topic. As a matter of fact, it's really very difficult to complete all aspects of the provisions of bail. Lots of books have been written. Lots of work has been done.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Sorry to interrupt. There is a message for all that don't start introducing yourselves in the chat box. The chat box is meant only for the queries which you have to post, and all the queries will be answered at the end of the session. So stop introducing yourselves in the chat box. And sorry, sir, you can continue.
Rightly it has been pointed out, I just forgot to let you all know. I'll be completing my talk within 40 minutes, 45 minutes, and we'll keep last 15 minutes for the question answer. So if you have any query, I would love to answer all those queries at the end of the talk. You can note down your queries between, and you can post the queries in the chat box. Now coming to the topic, I would not be going into reminding you the specific sections and the specific provisions integrated into the CRPC for the day. Rather, I would like to explain the very nuances of not only the bail but the ancillary issues relating to the bail. We all know that we have two kinds of offenses. One we call it as the bail and pool offense. Second we call it as the non-bailable offense. Whenever these offences are committed, the issue of bail comes into the play. Now, what is the bail? Is the bail defined in the CRPC? The answer is no. The provisions have been given, and I say that whenever the offences are committed, be it bailable or not bailable, and after commission of these offences, when the criminal justice machinery comes into the motion, and when the investigation or the inquiry starts, the accused is required to face the investigating officer or the magisterial court for the first time. Why I said magisterial court? Because when you are dealing with the private complaint cases, especially in non-cognizable cases, and most of the non-cognizable cases are, it's not 100% correct, but if you see the majority of the non Cognizable offenses are of the nature of the bailable offenses. Although there are, even in case of the cognizable offenses and non bailable offenses, I will completely fine. So I am not going into the exceptions. I am just stating what the generally we do it. So when the private complaint is filed, the proceedings would start before the court of the magistrate, and that is why I mentioned about the inquiry. But mostly, the bail insignificantly erect when the investigation is carried out by the investigating agency and the person is arrested. Even in the bailable offenses, it's not that the person cannot be arrested. The police can arrest the accused person, but if it is a bailable offense, the bail is your right and the arresting authority has to release you on bail, provided you are furnishing the personal bond and the security bond to the satisfaction of the arresting authority. There are certain other conditions, even in bailable and non-cognizable offenses. When the police would not release you on bail, obviously those are very exceptional kind of circumstances, like you have been arrested, your name is being asked, your name, identity, address, and you are not disclosing your name and identity, the police would be within its right not to release you on bail despite the fact that you have committed only the bailable offense. Now, when I move further, what all we are going to cover within this 40 minutes of our time period, we will be touching upon what is the mandatory bail, where the bail has to be granted, what I have just explained in cases of bailable offenses. Is there any other circumstance where the court would have no option but to grant the bail to the accused? That we'll be discussing. What is the default bail? We'll be discussing. We come across the various terminology. What is the interim bail? What is the regular bail? What is the anticipatory bail? What is the conditional bail? And if the bail is granted, whether that bail can be cancelled also, that we'll be discussing. Now, while granting the bail or denying the bail, what are the circumstances, what are the facts, what are the grounds which are taken into consideration by the court, that also we need to discuss. And many a times we hear that so and so has been released on probation. So what is this probation? Sometimes we hear that the person has been released on parole. So what is the parole? When the trial is concluded, the accused is convicted and therefore he becomes the convict and the appeal is filed. then we hear the suspension of sentence. Whether the suspension of sentence is an act of granting the bail, that also will be discussing. Now, straightway coming to the topic, let's see what is the mandatory bail. The bailable offences I have already cleared, that in all bailable offences, save certain exceptions, the arresting authority has to release the arrestee if the arrestee is agreeing to furnish the personal bond and the security bond. Before I move further, many times I am repeating this personal bond and the security bond. And also one more thing I would like to say, I can visualize, I can see that lot of advocates have also joined, but you have also to see that lots of students are also, in fact the majority are students in this webinar, so I am not going very deep into it. Then there might be certain aspects which may appear to be very, very trivial for the seasoned advocates, but you have to appreciate that this is very, very important for the student also. So my duty is to explain that particular thing. Now, what is this personal bond and the security bond? The surety bond. Now, when you are released on bail, it doesn't mean that you have been set free. Arrest means what? Arrest means your freedom to have the movement of your body as per your wish is curtailed. How it is curtailed? You have been taken into the custody initially mostly by the police. There are circumstances where even the private person can also make the arrest. I am not going into that. And after that, when the arrested person is presented before the magistrate and the magistrate grants the remand, either the police remand or the judicial remand, so you are put into either the police custody or in the judicial custody, and therefore your movement is restricted. You cannot go to any place of your choice. But if you see, when you are set at large on bail, you are still into the custody. Here, your jailer is your surety, the person who has taken surety. The surety, I have mentioned two things, the personal bond and the surety bond. Personal bond, that you are making a promise to the court that I'll be abiding by the conditions imposed upon me while granting the bail. One, and second, if I do not follow the conditions, more specifically the one condition, that is when you are directed to appear either before the some specific authority, and who is that specific authority? It is the investigating officer, or before the particular court on the date and time specified. So if you fail to attend, the court or the office of the investigating officer, then as per your promise, because you have promised to the court that you will be paying this much of the amount, and what is that amount? Amount would be specified by the court granting the bail or by the were arrested in the Elebulo offences, IAT has granted the bail when you have agreed to furnish the possible bond and the surety bond. So you have made that a particular promise to pay 10,000 rupees in the event of failing to comply with the conditions of the bail. And the similar promise is made by one independent person who says that I am taking the guarantee that he would be complying with the conditions, more specifically the one condition that he would be attending to the office of the investigating officer or the trial court on the date and time so directed. So most of the times we have a confusion that when the person is granted bail, are we required to deposit the that particular amount? Now, if you go in the practical aspect of it, you will find that at many places, and especially the special judges dealing with the corruption cases, they generally accept if you have made the fixed deposit of the amount, the amount which has been directed by the court for furnishing the personal bond and the surety bond, and that FD certificate has to be deposited with the court, or you may have to deposit the cash to the treasury. So this practice is also carried out in many of these states. But in most of the cases, the surety has to show that he has the potency or he has the amount in his hand in the form of some immovable or movable property to pay to the court in the eventuality the arrested person violates the conditions of the bail. I hope that this particular aspect I have been able to clear. Now again I'll be coming to the bail wala aspect. I was discussing about the mandatory bail. And I said that when the person is arrested, within 24 hours, this is the requirement of the CRPC, the investigation has to be completed. If you see section 57 of the CRPC, this is the mandate of the CRPC, but I have never come across a single case when the investigation is completed within 24 hours. And if that cannot be done, then what is the next? The arrested person has to be presented before the jurisdiction, before the magistrate, not the jurisdictional magistrate. And magistrate would be either at that point itself, he may grant the bail, or he may remand the accused person either to the police custody or to the judicial custody. And the further course of action would be taken, which the investigation would be completed, charging etc. would be filed, trial would be starting. Now here the two things you have to keep in your mind, that our criminal justice system follows a principle which we call it as the presumption of innocence. A person is presumed to be innocent until his guilt is proved beyond a reasonable doubt. Now the guilt has to be proved. How it could be proved? It can only be proved during the trial by leading the evidences. And for completion of the trial, it would take substantial time. Now on one hand, you are presuming a person to be innocent, and on another hand, you are keeping him in confinement. There's a contradiction. How this is a contradiction? Because the state is the custodian of the society, and when a person commits an offense, that offense is not only against an individual, but also against the society. And he becomes a danger to the society. He may commit another offense, but or once he has committed the offense and he is set at free, he may tamper with the evidences. Then that eventuality against the fair trial cannot be held. That has also to be ensured. So in order to strike balance between the two, the court comes into the play and deals with this aspect of the pain, and the court, having weighed the circumstances, either grants the bail or refuses to grant the bail. Now moving forward, what happens when there is a condition for mandatory bail? The one condition, I said that the minimal offense, done. Now the second condition, when the accused is put behind the bars, he is inside the jail, trial is going on, and there are a whole lot of witnesses to be examined, and it's not going to be completed within the near future, and the accused has been charged for an offense for which certain punishment is provided, and if the accused has already served at least half of the prescribed punishment, half of the maximum of the prescribed punishment, suppose a person had been arrested and he had been charged for having committed an offense of X. This offense of X, the maximum punishment is provided for 10 years. Now, the trial is going on and the person is inside the jail. 5 years have already gone by and the trial is still going on. So the moment he, now the five years is, the completed 5 years, that is the half of the maximum prescribed punishment. Therefore, in this case, classic CBR case. It's a very, very leading and prominent case. We almost go through it. And it was said that the registration of the FIR is not essential. What is the mandate of the CRPC? At this point is that the applicant must have the reasonable apprehension. That would suffice. Now, when the anticipatory bail is moved, and suppose it is moved where the allegation is of heinous crimes, then again, as I said, that our criminal justice jurisprudence rests on the principle that is presumption of innocence. And there is one more principle that we call it as the bail is the rule and jail is the exception. So the court has to ensure this, but at the same time, the court has also to see the interest of the societal interest. The court has also to ensure that the person is available to face the trial. So, there it comes that when the anticipatory bail is filed many times, the notice is given to the prosecution side, to the investigating agency, and in that case, the interim bail is granted. That he be not arrested till the time the petition is finally disposed of. But this interim bail cannot cross the total limit of 30 days.
Sir, it's absolutely fine. You can take your time.
Okay, thank you. So, now, what is the... granting the bail. But then, recently we have come across the case of the P. Chidambaram, where the Supreme Court said that merely because there is a grave offense accused against, accusation of grave offense against the accused, it cannot be the sole ground for refusing the bail. So this is one of the ground, but it cannot be the sole ground. Merely because grave offense has been, there is accusation of murder, therefore the bail cannot be granted. This cannot be the rule. The other attending circumstances have also to be seen. Now, the antecedent of the accused has also to be seen. Whether the accused is a habitual offender, there are other accusations also, he is facing other cases also. Whether in the previous cases when he was released on bail, he jumped over the bail, or during bail period, he committed certain other offenses. If there are such like situations, the court would be restraining from granting the bail. Now again, it would be seen whether if the person person, like political person, etc., or very senior officers, etc., or those who are very rich, if they are released on bail, they may kill the victim, they may threaten or kill the other witnesses, they may tamper with the evidences. So that would again be against the interest of the justice, because then the fair trial cannot be done. So this has also to be kept into the mind. Now, the very, very prominent fact at the deep roots into the society, and he would be available to face the trial when the time comes for the same, or he is likely to run away. Now we have seen certain big cases who are now fugitive, but one is arrested also in abroad. The Kingfisher Bodog. So this has also to be taken into consideration, that if such person is released on bail, and if he runs away from the reach of the law, major grounds which are to be kept into the mind while dealing with the bail applications. Do we have more time, Vishwamana?
Yes, sir, we can take time. No issues.
All right. Now, I'm not going into which court can grant the bail. We all know 436, 437, 438, 439, that is they, the Magistrate Court, the Court of Session, the High Court, the Supreme Court, all those courts are there. Now, let's see what is the probation and what is the parole. Is it the bail? In probation, we all know, when the probation is granted, probation is granted when the person, the accused, is convicted. After the conclusion of the trial court passes the judgment convicting the accused, and the accused now converts from the accused to the convict. And after conviction, what is the next? Surety bond, etc., are taken. Now here, what is the point to be noted? That the person is not put behind the bars. He is not inside the jail. Now he is released on parole, and certain conditions are imposed. There is well prescribed mechanism to deal with the parole. And if the person is found to have violated the sentence, so the sorry, parole. I have repeated many times the word parole. Parole, it's not parole, probation. I stand corrected. Erroneously, I used many times the word parole. It's a probation. When the person is convicted, but he's not sentenced, sentencing process is kept in abeyance. Then what is the parole? Parole is generally granted by the executive. I'm not going into the detailed procedure, but parole is granted when the convict is already inside the jail, he is serving the sentence, and it's a kind of leave given to the convict person from the jail in certain exigencies, like if there is a death in his family, the marriage of his daughter or the son, his maybe wife. Follow him, and it may be without police. And after completion of the parole period, the person has again to surrender to the jail authorities. We saw it in the case of the Sanjay Dutt. Most of the times he remained on the parole. So again here we would see that the parole is not a key to the bail. The parole is again after the conviction. And not only after the conviction, but also during serving the sentence. Now, quickly I would touch upon the last aspect, that is the suspension of sentence. Now, when the person is convicted and the convict prefers an appeal against the conviction and sentencing before the appellate court, so that appeal cannot be disposed of within one day, it would take time. And we also trial, that is the continuation of trial. Now the situation is little changed. If you see during the trial, we have the principle, we call it as the presumption of innocence. A person is presumed to be innocent until his guilt is proven beyond reasonable doubt. But once he is convicted, this principle goes out. This principle is not available to the convict. Because now his guilt has been proven beyond the reasonable doubt before the convict. That is the change in the circumstances. Now that is why the bail rules are not applicable in such like situations. The application seeking the suspension of sentence is moved, and that is considered by the appellate courts. And in our routine conversation, we say it as the granting of the bail. Now there is one very important aspect of the entire bail topic. Suppose during the investigation and trial is going on, or even during the investigation, you move that application before the court of session seeking the bail, and that application having been considered on its merit is dismissed. Now, whether in this situation, are you precluded from moving another bail application? Whether bar of res judicata would be applicable? The answer is negative. You can move as many bail applications as you like. But there is one condition. That once one bail application has been disposed of on its merit, the second bail application before the same court, and when I say same court, I don't mean that before the same judge, the court of the same jurisdiction, you should move only when there is a change in circumstance. You will have to show to the court that this is the change in circumstance from the time when first application was disposed of and this particular present application. If you are failed to show this change in circumstance, the subsequent bail application would not be entertained. It would be dismissed. Moving the bail application before the, suppose you put the bail application before the court of session, you can move the similar bail application before the High Court also. That can be done. There the change in the circumstance would not be applicable. But once the one bail application has been dismissed by the court of session, without there being change in circumstance, you cannot move the second bail application before the court of session. Now how there is a change of circumstance? Now one change of circumstance would take place every day, because one more day is added into the, you may always say that, you know, when I had moved the first bail application, I was behind the bars for 30 days. Now 2 days is the 31st day, so one day is added, so then change in circumstance. But then that should be the substantial change. Suppose you moved one application during the investigation, and the investigation is completed, charge is filed, so then you change the circumstance. You can always move the second application. Suppose that that bail application is dismissed, and the trial takes place. The evidence of the complainant or the victim is, or the material witnesses are complete. Then again, if there is a change in circumstance, you can move another bail application. So, one more thing I just forgot. Quickly I would say, when I was dealing with the default bail, I talked about the 90 days and the 60 days. This is regarding the offences done of the IPC offences. Those offences which are enumerated into the IPC. But what about the offences which are enumerated into the special enactments like PMLA, UAPA, MACOCA, etc.? So there the time limit is different, 180 days, etc. So you have to see what is the time limit prescribed in that particular special law. Now there is one more difference in general parlance. I said that the principle of presumption of innocence has to be prominently taken into consideration. But if you see the special laws like PMLA, UAPA, etc., NDPS, etc., then the situation is entirely different. In PMLA, there was a provision where it was mandated that the bail can only be granted when the accused satisfies the court that he is innocent, he has not committed this offense. Now, how he can satisfy? For that, he has to leave the evidence and suppose during the investigation, if it moving the bail application, there is no question of leading the evidence. Now that particular provision was challenged before the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court held that particular provision. Probably that provision is Section 41 of the PMLA. In the case Tarachand case, ultra virus, and the court said that this is purely arbitrary. And you cannot make such like law provisions. But again, there is similar provision in the NDPS which is still existing. So these are certain inherent contradictions in our criminal jurisprudence. But we are living with it, and with the passes of time, when the situation comes, perhaps the complicated court would be dealing with this. With this, I would be concluding my talk. Lot of other aspects were also to be touched, but then there is a paucity of time. If there is any question, I have not been able to see the chat. So if there is any question, I would love to deal with it.
Guys, if you have any question, please ask right now. Sir is there for you.
Sir, there are questions in the chat box. The first question is from Divya Goel. She asked that if anticipatory bail is not granted by district courts and the High Court, can we move to Supreme Court?
Yes. But Supreme Court, in the Court of Session and the High Court, you invoke the provision of Section 438 of the CRPC. Now, this jurisdiction is not available with the Supreme Court. So what do? We file the SLP. SLP can be filed against any order passed by any judicial and quasi-judicial authority. So that way, if the anticipatory bail is rejected by the High Court, so then we can always move before the Supreme Court through the SLP.
Sir, the next question is, when bail may be taken in cases of non-bailable offences?
When bail may be taken in cases of non-bailable offences?
Yes, sir.
So, see, bail has to be taken except the anticipatory bail. In fact, even if you see the anticipatory bail, this anticipatory bail has not been worded in the CRPC. An order is passed that in case of the petitioner being arrested, he is to be released on bail. So therefore, you would notice that bail is always granted when you are in custody. The prerequisite for granting of bail is that you must be in custody. In bailable offences, the moment you are taken into the custody, you have the inbuilt right mandatorily to be released on bail. So therefore, the arresting authority itself grants the bail. But there also, the condition is that you must be arrested. You must be in the custody. So, and in non-bailable offences, once you have been arrested, the police doesn't have the right to release you on bail. Arrest can be made by the police in non-bailable offences, in cognizable offences, but if the that cognizable offence is of the non-bailable nature, the police would not have the right to release you on bail, only the court can release you on bail. So the two conditions, that or you have been arrested. In the coverage of full offences and not
so
benefit
of so
that is a correct. Any other question, please?
Teri eyes nahi khul rahi thi. Sir, the next question is, one second. The next question is that what about person has staked bail on false case filed against him? What remedy he will have if investigation found that there was no offence? Can person file case against the person who filed false complaint? What state can take steps to file case against the person who filed the false case?
This is not directly connected with the topic bail, but I would deal with it. During the investigation, how can you say that this is false case? Even if the investigating agency concludes its investigation and in all the cases when the investigation is carried out, the police has to file the police report under section 173. And if the police comes to a conclusion that it is a false case, then obviously the person would not be arrested. Or if the material which has emerged on record to show the involvement of the arrested person or the accused person to be the least, he would be granted the bail. But innocence, etc., has to be determined by the court of law. But then, again, there is a provision that even if the investigating authority, after conclusion of the investigation, comes to a conclusion that it is a false case, false allegation has been made, the police has the right to prosecute a such complainant. One, that this would be done by the state itself, state means the police. Second would be, when the police report is filed, suppose the police say that in our opinion, the person has not committed the offence. Say for example, the Arushi murder case, the CBI filed the police report before the magistrate, saying that, we do not have the sufficient evidence to accuse the parents of the Arushi, and therefore we are not filing the charge sheet. But then the magistrate said that, sorry, I am very much satisfied on the basis of the material which has been brought by the investigating agency itself. And they said that I am taking cognizance and I would put it further. And then the trial took place. And not only trial took place, but they were convicted, but in appeal they have been acquitted. Now, in such like situation, if after the conclusion of trial, then again there will be two situations. One situation where the trial court acquit you, giving you the benefit of doubt, and another case may be where you are ordinarily acquitted because of the lack of the evidence. So in cases of the benefit of doubt, generally obviously you have the various remedies available to you, but generally the court doesn't give the relief. But when you are honorably acquitted, there you can seek for the compensation. The court itself can give the compensation, and you can prosecute the complainant for the false prosecution, for the defamation, and obviously you can bring this civil litigation also. seeking the exorbitant compensation. I hope this satisfies the query.
Yes, sir. Sir, the next question is whether the protection granted to a person under Section 438 CRPC should be limited to a fixed period so as to enable the person to surrender before the trial court and seek regular bail?
Very, very, very good question, and I'm sorry because of the time, this particular
Sir, the next question is, sir, for how long a person is granted release on parole?
Come again, please. You were not audible.
For how long a person is granted release on parole?
Parole. Yes, it is to be. As I said that it has a very, it has its own procedure. Chiefly, it is, this decision is taken by the executive. Obviously, there is a court interference also. But it is the main job of the executive. And in piecemeal, it is given, several times we have seen in the case of the surrender. Let me come to this very important question of the first question, the whether the time limit can be given for the anticipated bail orders. Now, this is what used to happen earlier, and still it is happening. I dealt with a case before the Allahabad High Court, where the very limited anticipated bail was granted till the time of completion of the investigation, and then the court is silent. Now the Supreme Court has dealt with it, and now the current situation is that the Supreme Court has said that there is no such provision in the anticipatory bail of the provision of the anticipatory bail 438. Interim bail 30 days, that's fine. When the bail application is not disposed of. But once you are disposing of the anticipated bail application, it has to be till the end. Till the end, that is, till the conclusion of the trial. It cannot be for the limited period. This is what the Supreme Court has said. So, we should insist upon for this, but still, we find very rampantly that the courts are passing, the limited anticipated bail. Although it is not happening in the Delhi, but if you see in the UP and other states, it is happening. Any other question, please?
Sir, the next question is that, is there any difference between considerations and conditions for granting bail? How does the court decide these parameters while granting or not granting the bail?
Yes, the consideration as we use in the contract, law of contract, that is not so in our criminal jurisprudence. Consideration, it's considering, it's a plain meaning has to be taken into account. Conditions, yes, I explained during my talk, the conditions, the gravity of the offense, but then again, in each individual case, the Supreme Court said that it cannot be the sole ground, because the accusation is of very grave nature. So, merely on this ground, the bail cannot be denied. Then the antecedents of the petitioner has to be seen, whether he is the first timer, young person, or he has been habitual one. What has been his antecedents in previous cases, whether he was following the conditions of the bail, or he jumped over the bail, or committed other offenses while being on bail. This has also to be taken into consideration. Whether he is likely to fly away, whether he is likely to run away from the clutches of the law, that has also to be taken into consideration. whether he is likely to interfere with the evidences, he is likely to cause harm to the victim and the other witnesses. This has also to be taken into consideration. Whether he is likely to exert influence over the witnesses and the other connected persons, that has also to be taken into consideration. These are the conditions which are to be taken into by the judge while dealing with the bail application. But then again, at the same time, has also to see, you know, how long would it take in completion of the trial or in completion of the investigation. Then again, we talked about the principle of innocence, and it has also to be related into the special law offenses. There we said that, you know, the heavy burden is put on the accused to show that he is innocent, whereas in other cases, the burden is on the prosecution. So this has also to be seen. So these are the conditions which are to be taken into consideration.
So the last question is that what is the difference between rejection and cancellation of bail? What can be the grounds for the same?
Yes, yes. Rejection is that when your bail application is considered on merit and the court does not agree to grant you the bail. And that is how your bail is rejected. Cancellation is when you have been granted bail. And I was to deal with this particular aspect, but I could not. Now, you have been granted bail. But the conditions which were imposed upon you while granting the bail, you have violated. Suppose in the rape case, you have been granted bail. One of the conditions is that you would not be seen in the vicinity of the victim's residence, and you have been found roaming around her home. Now this is the violation of the condition. There's a condition that you would not be tampering with the evidences, or you would not be influencing the witnesses, and you have been found contacting with the witnesses. This is the violating the conditions of the bail. Now under these circumstances your bail can be rejected. So for that, the application seeking rejection of bail has to be moved before the court who had granted the bail. So the difference between the two is that in one, when the bail application itself is rejected on merit. Second, the cancellation would arise where the bail is granted, you are enjoying the bail protection, but during that period you have violated the conditions of the bail and the aggrieved person has approached the court seeking the cancellation of the bail because you have violated the conditions of the bail. This is the difference between the two.
Sir, one more last question is there. Is an anticipatory bail should be time bound, since an application for unfettered bail can be considered only upon the completion of investigation?
See, I answered this question just a few minutes before. There was one question. So I answered to it. You know, there is a judgment from the Supreme Court, I'm just forgetting the name of that particular judgment, recently it has come. Now the Supreme Court has very clearly held that once you are granting the anticipatory bail, it should not be time bound. Means once you have granted the anticipatory bail, it is done. Anticipatory bail till the end, that is till the conclusion of the trial. Practically, especially if you see in the UP and other states, the courts are very rapidly granting the time-bound anticipatory bail, that is for 1 month, for 2 months, till the time of completion of the investigation, till the time of start of the evidence, till the time of conclusion of the prosecution evidence. Now once the highest court has given the verdict and according to Article 141, it becomes the law of the land. So this has to be followed by all the courts. Now it is for we the lawyers to apprise the court that my lord, now if my lord is granting the anticipatory bail, it should be the unfettered one. It should not be the conditional. So this is my answer to the question.
Okay guys, due to shortage of time, I would like to say that we will not take up any other queries. We are sorry for the same. And Honorable Advocate Ashok sir, team members and all the participants here, I, Shobhna Agarwal, co-founder and managing director of Law Statistics, on behalf of team Law Statistics, would like to extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our honorable speaker for such a wonderful session. We are really enlightened by your knowledge, sir. And with these warm words and a kind message, we move to the end of today's webinar.
Excuse me, madam. I'm Advocate Rajan. A fantastic sir, senior and fantastic answer. I think only one point still have to be clear, that bail is time bound, anticipated by bail is not time bound.
Yes, I said that it cannot be time bound. Only the thing, only one thing, I got to what you want to have the clearance. Let me make it clear.
Okay.
In the anticipatory bail, as I said, that because you are not in custody. What is the order? Order is that to be released on bail in the eventuality of having been arrested. So it's not that you cannot be arrested if you are like the protection of the anticipatory bail. Now, what practically happens? The moment you get the anticipatory bail protection, the offense becomes a kind of bailable offense. It would come at par with the bailable offense, which you can be arrested and you will be arrested. But the moment you are arrested, you have to be released on the bail. And you will be furnishing the personal bond as the surety bond. Now suppose, during the investigation, the police did not arrest you. Because once you are arrested, arrest memo has to be raised. And then again, because you are enjoying the anticipatory bail, then the police would be entitled to release you on bail, despite the fact that it is a non-bailable offense. So, the police itself would